Tell your neighbor there's a possibility that they could leave with a gift today. Go ahead. Amen. Awesome. Now, if you got those tickets when you came in, don't hide them, because in just a couple points here, you're going to need those tickets. We're going to give out some gifts, and as a matter of fact, Sharon, I don't have the gifts, so we're going to have to get those, okay? But I'm going to read the text right now. The Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, the first 20 verses, okay? In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. There were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, what did he say, church? Amen. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths, lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, hey, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that's happened, which the Lord has told us about. So they hurried off, and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in a manger. And when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. All who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Lord, I ask you to make this a reality in our hearts today. That, Lord, we don't just read the Christmas story and say, well, we read it again this year. Lord, it is my prayer that it's a reality for each and every one of the ears that are hearing and all the hearts that are experiencing this today in your precious name. Amen. Amen. The first point, if you're following in your outline, counting and taxing of man is used to bring the whole family or the Holy Family to Jesus' prophesied birthplace. You see, the governor and the politicians all got together and they said, at this time, we are going to bring everybody to Bethlehem here that belongs to the family of David. They all have to come here and they all have to be counted so we can tax them and so we know how many people we have. So once again, God uses even unbelievers to make his perfect will come to pass. If you can read the story with me today, like you've just listened to it, and if you think about it, wonder what Mary and Joseph felt like when they found out that this is the timing that there was for them to travel to Bethlehem and to go and register. I don't know about you guys, but I'm thinking they're probably not going, oh, this is a great time to go on a trip. The fact again, though, God uses even unbelievers. He uses circumstances in the world to get the Holy Family, to get Mary and Joseph to Bethlehem on the exact day that Jesus is to be born. Now, I wonder how many of you sitting in here and listening right now are in a situation where you're going, God, what in the world are you doing? And why does it have to be this way? And why are the circumstances working out the way they are? And this can't be your will, Lord God. It's very easy for me to look at Joseph and Mary and think they might be thinking, this can't be what God wants us to do today. But the fact is, God knew exactly what he was doing with Mary and with Joseph and with Jesus and everybody in the story. And God knows exactly what he's doing with you today. And so it's my prayer that during the Christmas story here, you'll look at it and the reality of it and say, Lord, wherever I'm at, have your way. Lord, fulfill your perfect will in my life. That's really what he was doing, even though it doesn't, you know, seem that way, I would believe, to them. And it doesn't even seem that way for us. That's exactly what God is doing. Verses 6 and 7, it says, while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son, and she wrapped him in cloths, placed him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Here's the point if you're following in your notes. Two sentences describe our hero's birth. It's amazing to me when you read the story. I mean, I know the angels give the birth announcement and everything, but when it comes to what actually happens, there are two sentences in the scripture that describe, and I wrote in here, our hero's birth. If you guys were trying to fill out and get ahead of me in your outlines, I bet you wrote our Savior's birth. The reason that I changed that and I put our hero's birth is because I want you to see Jesus as your hero. We speak words like Lord, and we speak words like Savior. And if you go to church all the time, it just means, okay, that's God, and you just move on. But I want you to see that Jesus is your hero. People will spend $10 or $15 to go see a movie about Captain America and Superman. And they'll sit for a couple hours in a theater, and they'll wish that, you know, they could find the Hulk, you know, to rescue them. And the point this morning is Jesus is your hero. He's the one that was sent to pay the ransom. He's greater than anything man can dream up. And man dreams up some doozies, don't they? And I'm guilty, man. I love comic book movies. It's great, man. They come and they rescue everybody. But the reality is Jesus is our hero. Now here is the point, all right? The greatest gift ever given to man is Jesus of Nazareth. The greatest gift. We've been walking around. I mean, one of my friends and I, we've been asking everybody we see, why do you wrap gifts? And yesterday was the first time I had one young lady say, because they wrapped Jesus on Christmas morning. I was like, I slapped her five. I said, you're the first person that said that. I've had people just tell me, I don't have a Bible. How can I know? Because I won't give them the answer. I say, it's in Luke chapter 2. Look it up. I don't own a Bible. But they were carrying an iPhone. I said, you can download it in probably less than 2 minutes. Put it on your phone. The point, once again, Jesus is the greatest gift that's ever been given to man. Now, if you have those tickets, get them out, okay? And there's a method to my madness here. I want you to do this when you get together with your families in the next couple days or hours or however it's going to be. And usually we have a big Christmas program and we have door prizes at intermission. And this year we don't have the Christmas program, but the door prizes still came. And so we're going to give something away to you. That's why I said you might get something when you come to church today. We want to feed you spiritually, but we can do it do it here. Now, this is a little Switzerland gift certificate. Don't know exactly what little Switzerland is, but you'll find out when you open the envelope, okay? And I'm going to read the number, and I'm going to ask you to come up and get it. It's 63073. Is that person in here? All right. Mrs. Knapp, awesome. So in honor of the greatest gift ever given to man, Jesus, I'm giving you that gift. Amen. The next one is Hawks View Golf Club gift certificate. Golfers, get your tickets out. All right, 63090. Nate, awesome. Once again, in the honor of the greatest gift ever given to man. Merry Christmas, Nate. Awesome. Next Door Pub and Pizzeria. Woo. All right. 63110. 110. Who has that one? Don't be bashful. Anybody have it? Your ticket's out in the hallway. Okay. If you don't have it, going once, twice, three times, there it goes. Okay. Next one. 63093. Have to have your ticket to redeem it. This is just like heaven, folks. You better be ready. 63092. All right, Bobby, here you go. We knew if we kept calling him sooner or later. Merry Christmas, Bobby. In honor of Jesus. Awesome. You ready for the next one? Popeyes on Lake Geneva. Y'all got your tickets? 63123. That's a great number. 63123. Awesome. In honor of the greatest gift ever given to man. Merry Christmas, brother.
Thank you.
Awesome. All right. Aurora Wellness Center gift certificate. Here we go. All right. Merry Christmas. Awesome. Please try to remember when you give gifts away, it's in honor of Jesus. What are we doing this for? What's it all about? That's what it's about. It'll take some of the craziest parties going to go on in the next few days and bring it right home to what it's all about. If we just remember it, okay? Now, following back in your notes, all of Scripture resides in a manger in Bethlehem. Don't miss this point. All of Scripture resides in a manger in Bethlehem. John chapter 1, verse 14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. I loved it. I don't know if it was a choir or the worship team singing, but when they said Isaiah was there, all the prophecies from the very beginning of the Bible, think about Genesis chapter 3 when God says, you know, the enemy, he will strike at your heel, but you'll crush his head. He was talking about Jesus coming to redeem us and to wipe out the enemy. All of the Scriptures, all everything written about Jesus. There's two sentences there say, he was born, they wrapped him in cloths, they laid him in a manger. But the point is, they've been writing about Jesus all through the Bible, all the way up to that point. And everything that has been written and spoken about him up to this point. I was reading one time, it says there's more written about Jesus before he was born than is written about the most famous men in the world after they have been born and been famous. And once again, all of Scripture resides in a manger in Bethlehem. It amazes me all the things that we've thought up from those two sentences. All of the scenes of Joseph and Mary coming to the inn, you know, knocking on the door. It all comes from those two sentences. It doesn't say what happened. Doesn't say what happened. But this much I know, he came to his own and they had no room for him. John 1:11. Whenever I read that, usually in the Gospel of John, and it says that he came to his own. See, he came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. You think of Jesus when he's grown up and in ministry, and when he goes and when they reject him, when the Jews reject him as the Messiah. But yet, it didn't start when he was older and when he entered into ministry. It started from the day he came to earth. And when he went to Bethlehem, they wouldn't accept him in the inn. They didn't have room for him, and he went to a stable. Hence, I believe the saying, what's wrong? Were you born in a barn? Has anybody ever, I've had that told me tons of times. Wasn't born there, but I spent a lot of my time there. Now, in all seriousness, I believe Jesus was born where he was and in a stable and in the humble setting he was, so that none of us could say, well, I'd love to meet God, but he's up there in the palace and I can't go. I'll never get past security. See, that's not the case with Jesus. Jesus was born in the most humble place, in the most humble dwelling, so that he's approachable. The fact that they call him Emmanuel, God with us, means he's approachable, and therefore he was born in the most humble of place so we can all go to him. No one is excluded. Your next point, the bread of life is in the house of bread. John chapter 6, verse 35, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. You see, he declared, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. But I want you to know, if you go on any of the you know, commentaries and things, and if you look up Bethlehem, it means the house of bread. And Jesus, the bread of life, was born in the house of bread, and he was laid in a manger there. That's why Jesus said things like, unless you eat my flesh and you drink my blood, you'll have no part in my kingdom. It's a spiritual truth that we have to get, and we have to feed on Jesus spiritually. And you have no life in you without him. And if you walk about in the world today, and if you go around and if you meet people and you see people are hopeless, it's because they're all feeding on something other than the bread of life. And so here in the Christmas story, the bread of life is in the house of bread. And when people say the Bible doesn't fit together and there are so many discrepancies, talk to them about that, okay? It fits together perfectly. God knew exactly what he was doing. In verse 8, the shepherds are about to meet the good shepherd. It says there were shepherds abiding out in the field, watching over their sheep, and they're about to meet the greatest shepherd to ever be born, the good shepherd, John chapter 10. Have you ever heard the saying, it takes one to know one? Maybe that's why the angel came to the shepherds first. They're about to meet the greatest shepherd in the world, who is also pure and spotless Lamb of God. They're getting ready to be introduced to him. The next point in your outline, God interrupts everyday life and makes it exciting. Anybody here ever been bored? How many times you hear that? I'm so bored. How can you be bored if God is in your life? You just never know what's going to happen. I could keep you here the rest of the morning telling you stories that God has done in my life since I gave my heart to Jesus. I've been working on a farm, just minding my own business, you know, everyday life. I remember one day I had these two tractors running. I'm filling silo. I'm just enjoying my life. And my friend brings this guy to me, and he comes walking up to me, and he says, "Dave, meet Dr. So-and-so." And he tells me he's got a PhD, and he's got all this, and he's got all that. And he goes, "Dave, tell him about Jesus." I'm like, "What are you doing? I'm filling silo. I got two tractors running. What do you bring them here to me for?" And he goes, "I'll watch your tractors. Talk to them." Okay. See what God does? He'll interrupt. I'm telling you that story because you might think you are in a place that it's unlikely that God's going to use you. That's wrong. God will interrupt you in everyday life. These shepherds were out in the field just minding their own business. They were just hoping they could get through the night without a coyote or a wolf or a lion or a bear coming to get the sheep. And God said, "I'm about to interrupt you, fellas." Wow. Could you imagine what that was like? Verses 9 through 14, if you're following in your outline, the greatest birth announcement ever. If you study the Bible, you should ask questions. Who, what, when, where, how? If we do this and we think about the greatest birth announcement that was ever given, how was it delivered? By angels. One first, and then he was joined with a host of angels. Isn't that what it says in the text? And the angel came and he interrupted the shepherds. The glory of the Lord shone around him. And he came and he had a specific message. Now, when? He said to them, today in the city of David, there's born to you a Savior. I want you to know this, church. If you're in here today, maybe Jesus is not anything special to you yet. If you've never given your heart to Jesus, then he hasn't become your Lord and Savior. He's not your hero. If he's not your hero, today could be the day. Jesus could be born in your heart today. If not, there was a day that you gave your heart to Jesus. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, Paul said, "Now today is the day of salvation." In Hebrews chapter 3 and 4, "Today if you hear his voice, harden not your heart." This day the shepherds heard the voice of God. The angel came in God's glory and said, "Today in Bethlehem is born to you a Savior." I'm all wound up right now. I just want to go out on the street and start shouting that. Today is born to you a Savior. Hallelujah. Who is born? Oh, he's a baby and he's wrapped in a manger. That just had to be a strange story for them. But it didn't intimidate them. They weren't afraid to go to a stable. They weren't afraid to see a baby wrapped up and lying in a manger. It was familiar to them. And that's what was going on. That's who is born. What is he? He's Messiah and he's Lord. And the shepherds had to be going, "Wow. You're kidding. Where is he?" In the town of David, in a manger. Once again, in the city of David, if you were a Bible student, you would know that meant Messiah. In the Gospel of Matthew, the king has to say to the priest and all the wise guys sitting around him, "Where's this guy supposed to be born?" And they look up Micah and it says, "In Bethlehem." And immediately, that's Messiah. That's the King of Kings. That's the Lord of Lords. If you know the Scripture. To whom is he sent? I love this. If you read the text, it says to all people. Isn't it great that it doesn't say just to the people living here in Bethlehem? Just to the people in the United States of America? No, that's not what it says. A lot of people think that's what it is. But that's not true. It's for all people. I don't know why God's telling me to do this, but I have to ask you a question. Do you ever look at somebody and think, oh, that person's never going to come to Christ? I'm telling you, God has taken me to the woodshed so many times when I've thought that. And I'll see somebody and I'll go, the chances of that guy getting saved are like slim to none. And boy, God just comes after me with the Holy Spirit and says, you cannot say that. Because his arm is not short. God can save any soul. And I never give up. In all honesty, the worse they seem, the more excited I get now. That is a testimony coming. That's a testimony. And it's for all people. To whom is he sent? To all people. Nobody is exempt. There's nobody out there that can get away. Here's another thought. Maybe God's going to use you to introduce them to Jesus. Your next point, angels bring glory to God and peace to men on earth. Isn't that what they say? Glory to God in the highest and peace to his people on earth. Now, it is my prayer today that you bring glory to God. You were created for God's glory. That is to be your purpose in life, to bring glory to God. You were created for his glory. When people have an identity crisis, it's because they don't understand that God wants glory through you. It's powerful. But it also says peace to men on earth. Church, isn't that what the world is looking for right now? All the debates to have a gun or not to have a gun is about peace. It's about safety. It's about being secure. And you know what the enemy wants to do? He wants to make the world afraid so that they won't go to church, that they won't go to the movies, that they won't go to the mall because maybe something bad could happen. I have a solution for all that thinking. Get saved. Get bought by the blood of Jesus. Give your heart to Jesus. Know where you're going to go when you die, and I have no fear. Then I'm not afraid. Then I know where my eternal destination is. And eternity is a lot longer than what this life has to offer. Do you know that? So if you weigh the two, make sure you know where you're going. God wants me to tell you this story. When I was in Tomahawk witnessing around the Redeemer's Ride this year, there's a helmet there, and on the outside of the helmet is heaven. It's streets of gold. It's the river of life. It's all these things, and you tell people if your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, here's where you're going, and they're like, oh, it's so cool. And then you go, but there are other books. And if your name's not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and if your name is in another book, then you turn it over and you go, here's your eternal destination. And there's a dragon and hellfire inside the helmet. And when one guy saw it, he went running and screaming across the lawn. And he just ran away. Another guy looked at it with me and he went, you just wouldn't want to put your head in there, would you? Bring glory to God and peace on earth. He said, I just don't want to put my head in there. And we said, then there's a solution. You give your heart to Jesus. Ask him to forgive you of your sins. It's what this story is about. It's what the reality of Jesus is about. To bring glory to God and peace on earth. And you don't have to get perfect before you have the peace. You have to give your heart to Jesus, and that's when the peace comes. greatest Christmases I ever spent were the years where I got saved, man, because finally it meant something to me. Radiant beams from thy holy face with the dawn of redeeming grace. It became true. It was reality. Verses 15 and 16, the shepherds act in faith upon heavenly news. Now, you can't miss this. You see, you can be in here today and you can believe all of this story. You can believe Jesus is the Son of God. But unless you act on it, you get nowhere. There are so many people in churches today who know all of the knowledge. They have all the head knowledge. They know about salvation. They can quote Scripture. But they don't do it. There's no action. And I love the shepherds because they didn't go, hey, that was really awesome, man. Did you see how he lit up the sky? I saw number 32 over there. If you're having some trouble, I'm going to go get the sheep, okay? That's not what they did. It says immediately when the heavenly host of angels departed, they said, let us go and see this thing that we've been told about. And people go and they hear a message and they learn about salvation. And then they go home and say, okay, what's on TV? What's for dinner? You know what I want to tell you? Try this out. I dare you to live a holy life. I challenge you to live a holy life and see what kind of fruit comes from it. You'll start sleeping better than you've ever slept before in your life. It raised my average in bowling 15 or 20 pins. My cows produced more milk. It's just the truth. When you begin to apply what God's had, the shepherds did that. They said, okay, let's go see. Let's go see what we've been told about. And God's word is proven true. That's your next point. You see, God's word is true. They went, and it says it in the text. It says they found it exactly as they were told. There are going to be some seriously depressed, unbelieving people in this world when they find out that God's word happens exactly the way it's been written down. And they're going to stand before the judgment throne, before the judgment seat of God. And they're going to go, we didn't know. And God's going to say, it was written down for you. I recorded it and I kept it for all eternity. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word abides. That's what he says. And God's word is true. And when he comes back, people, you're going to hear, I hope I don't hear it. I don't want to hear all the crazy excuses. But God's word is true. Verses 17 through 20, shepherds preach the gospel. I love this. Who were the first preachers? The angels came and said, hey, Jesus is born, but they went to see him, and it says when they came away, they couldn't keep their mouths shut. They were telling everybody about the baby that they had just seen. And they were telling them, angels appeared to us. You know, the town had to be going, woo, these guys are a little bit off here tonight. But they were certain, man. They had seen Jesus. They had heard the angels. They had seen the sky illuminated. I love it. The listeners, it says, were amazed. Because the Spirit of God was there. And I love this. It says they returned praising God. Once again, that's their purpose, isn't it? That's their purpose. They went and they saw that little baby and they recognized God's grace. And they came back praising God going, woo! We thought this was going to be just a regular night. And they were glorifying God. And then it says, Mary treasures and ponders. If I can just exhort you to do something today, go home and read the Christmas story. If If you don't want to read it, listen to it. And listen to the Christmas story and read the Christmas story and stop and meditate on it. And God will bring revelation to you. I love this artist, Michael Card. He wrote a song. He said, God's final word is Jesus. Amen. Folks, that took a little bit of reading Scripture and meditating and pondering and treasuring like Mary does here. And he went, wow. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That's all God had to do, and that's all he had to say. Right there it is. That's powerful. I want to end in 1 Timothy chapter 3. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. It's an awesome text. And it says, beyond all question, the mystery of godliness is great. What you are seeing in the Christmas story, lying in the manger, all of Scripture, lying in a manger in Bethlehem, you are seeing the mystery of godliness. And it's great. It's powerful. He, Jesus, appeared in a body. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. He was vindicated by the Spirit. This is just awesome. Think about the story we've read in the past couple of weeks. You know, when Zechariah said, how is this going to be, man? My wife is old and she's barren and we can't have a baby. And he said, no, you are going to have a baby. Elizabeth's going to conceive. And then the son is going to be filled with the Holy Spirit, even in his mom's womb. That's why John the Baptist jumped up and down when he met Jesus and he was in his mom's womb. Mary said, how can this be? I'm a virgin. I can't get pregnant. He said, the Holy Spirit will come upon you. The mystery of godliness is great. The Spirit of God will come upon you. He will make this happen. I wonder how many people are in here today going, yeah, but I'm in this situation and I don't know how to get out of it and what's going to happen. The Holy Spirit can make it happen, church. There are so many times I'm stumped. I don't know which way to turn. I'm overwhelmed. And God goes, will you just sit down and relax? I got this. And he'll work it all out. And I go, Lord, once again, I go, Lord, I am so sorry. I didn't put my hope and trust in you like I should have. He appeared in a body. He was vindicated by the Spirit. The Spirit bears witness to Jesus every place. And one of the first books I read as a Christian is called The Helper by Catherine Marshall. You know how she explains the Holy Spirit? He's like a guy in Hollywood with a spotlight, and all he ever does is hold the spotlight on Jesus. Wherever Jesus goes, he's in the spotlight. He's vindicated by the Spirit. He was seen by angels. He was seen by angels. He was announced by angels. I believe he was protected by angels. They knew him before he came to earth, didn't they? They served him then. He was preached among the nations. It started already in the Christmas story. The shepherds come away going, you got over there in that stable, you got to go see what's there, man. It's awesome. The place is lit up. He was preached. I think that's missing so much in our world today, church. We need to preach Jesus. We need to tell people about Jesus. He came for everybody. We should be telling everyone about him. He was believed on in the world. The shepherds believed. There are magi coming from the east that believed. There are people that believe. Do you believe on Jesus? That's what this is about. He was taken up in glory. He came from glory and he goes back to glory. And right now, today, this morning, at this very moment, Jesus is interceding for you. He's seated next to the Father. And he's coming and he's saying, Dad, come on. That one's mine. If you're in here this morning and you've never given your heart to Jesus, do it right now. Today is the day of salvation. Find out where you're going to spend eternity by doing this. Just tell Jesus in your heart. Say, Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. He longs to hear that. Ask him to forgive you of your sins. Admit that you've sinned. Humble yourself before the mighty hand of God. That's the easy part. You ready for the tough part? Tell him to come with his Holy Spirit and take over your life. Let go of the reins. Give God the keys. Whew. Just let him take over. Then go out and tell everybody you know about Jesus. Live your life for him. Heavenly Father, we come today in the precious name of Jesus. Lord, there are people listening to this message that are going to spend their first Christmas without their spouse. There are people listening to this message that they think they just don't know how they're going to survive another day. Lord, come with the power of your Holy Spirit and bring revelation, bring guidance from your Spirit. Lord Jesus, for the hopeless, bring hope. For those that feel unloved, let them know that you did not stay in heaven, but you sent your only begotten Son as a little baby in a manger so that everybody could come and everybody could receive salvation. For all people, today in the city of David is born Christ the Lord. Lord, I lift up each and every person in here and all the gatherings we're going to in the next few days. Lord, help us to have the light of Jesus shining from us so that everybody in the place understands what this is really about, what we're really celebrating, the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in your precious name. Amen. Amen. If you need prayer, I'd love to pray with you. If you need time at the altar, there's time at the altar. If not, you're free to go in peace, to love and serve the Lord. Remember, tomorrow night's Christmas Eve service, and Merry Christmas. Amen.